Welcome to yet another episode of Movement Medicine. First, we'd like to thank the partners. So Fit India Movement, thank you so much for partnering with us. Back to Fitness, the clinic I run, Lal Trudhai, the race I've been putting together in Ladakh for the last 10 years. It ranges from 55 kilometers to 555 kilometers. And then finally, the movie, Moving Mountains Within, based on the 10th edition of Lal Trudhai. Now coming to our special guest today. So today is a special edition because for the first time we'll be having a couple, doctor couple, who are here. So Rushad, Kamna, Rushad, welcome on board, guys. How are you guys doing?
We're good, as good as can be with the lockdown going on.
Guys, so jumping into your academic and professional background, please tell me, what have you been up to? How did you get here, wherever you are right now?
So I'm an ophthalmologist. I trained in Manipal for my undergraduation, followed by my post-graduation in Regional Institute of Ophthalmology in Kerala. After that, I did my super specialization in corneal transplants, LASIK and cataract surgery from Narayan Nethralaya, Bangalore. So that's pretty much my training.
And now he works at Trophy Center. I am a pathologist by training and I am finding other things to do in life. So a little bit lab work, but largely, yeah.
So where did you guys meet? Where did you go to college?
So we went to Manipal. We met in Manipal, actually.
I was there in 2005 and then Kamna joined us in 2006.
So we are sort of fossils by the amount of time we've been seeing each other and then consequently married. So yeah, how many was 14?
14 years.
So we met in Manipal and then I was in Manipal for my post-graduation as well. So I've been in Manipal pretty much, the south. Most of us have been in the south for a very long time, which we love. So now we're back in Delhi.
Great. So what about being active, playing sports? Have you always been physically active? Did you pick it up later? Did you meet each other and then become active? How has it been?
So when I was in school and in Manipal, I used to play a lot of football. I was also part of the tennis team for my batch. I did play cricket initially as well. In Manipal, I was in the football team for the batch as well.
He was my third football coach.
And yeah, I used to coach the girls' team at times as well.
He was coaching the batch's team, but then he would coach me too. And then he was in this Dharam Sankat because he didn't know whether to cheer for me when my batch played against their batch ever.
So it was a bit of a conflict of interest in that sense. Also been into things like swimming. I play a lot of golf. Golf was my, I would say, my first love as a sport. Then I left it for a while in the middle when I was doing my post-graduation.
But
I've got back to it thanks to Kamna. I think she pushed me back towards golf. And we recently did a trip to Scotland to as a golf tour, which I undertook with a couple of my cousins. And
I don't
was quite
play
a
golf,
lot of fun. And I think Kamna had a nice hike.
I had a nice time golf. Because I was walking. I love walking. I love hiking. So thankfully, all the courses in Scotland are set beautifully wherever we went, at least. And they're free to walk on. They don't stop you like in India or other places. So I just walked and walked. I think I was covering some 16 kilometers every day, happily, not worried, nothing. It was beautiful. It was good. So the advantages, so I actually had more fun than these guys because they'd get frustrated in their game. And I would have had this fantastic time because I would be alone on these beautiful beaches. And yeah, so that was good. And so I didn't know that Rushad apparently was good enough in golf to the championship level, but left it as all good doctors do and made the sacrifice for our the great esteemed profession. But yeah, so that's why I pushed him back. I'm like, I can't believe you did this, because if I had been there at that point, I would have given you one tight slap and said, go back to golf, not medicine. So yeah.
It's never too late, Kamna. You know, you can go ahead and attempt it right away.
I will be on the senior tour after the age of 50.
What about you, Kamna? You didn't say enough about yourself. Please share something.
I have always been athletic. My parents have always pushed us for, like, you know, they'd go for walk, they'd drag us along, even in summer holidays all the time. They were great people for playing badminton. So from a very early age, we were playing. My mother was great. She loved table tennis. So that. So we were always encouraged to be active. And especially my mom, she really like encouraged us. And you know, there are times when you're growing up, when you hit puberty, you get your period and you know, you don't want to do anything. And that's one of the things my mom did. She pushed, she told us there's no reason to stop your life because of this. You need to move. So I think for me, my parents have been a great part in helping us move. And I always played. I played basketball in school. I really wanted to learn football. And at that time, nobody taught football to girls. But I forced our teacher, and there were 2-3 of us who would play in the mornings like the boys were during the assembly time. Then we went to college again, kept playing, kept running. And football, played football in college again. And these guys were trying to train us. But it was always sad because girls were given like one fourth of the football field.
It was one fourth
of the football field to play on. Because
now, what are you complaining about? That's big enough, isn't it? What do you say, Rishad?
What? I'm sorry.
When the whole length of the field gets tiring.
Whatever.
Jokes apart, Kamna, this is an interesting point that you've touched. So, you know, this periods and girls getting physically inactive starting from that age onwards because you're supposedly impure during that time and you're not supposed to be moving, you're delicate, you know, those things being told by the parents or the society. And here you are, you kept working through it, exercising, and your parents motivating you. Please, please throw more light on it, please.
Yeah, I think it was also discomfort. But then, you know, at our time, like, you know, I can understand till, so, you know, the really thin path, they came when I was 2 years into having my menstruation, my menstrual cycle. And I think that really made a difference because that suddenly frees you up. And it makes you more comfortable moving. So I think it's entirely, it's just a mindset. It's really not a different point in life. It's, yes, you are uncomfortable. So it's okay to take that little time off when you are, you know, you're cramping. You obviously can't do. But I found this for me and a lot of other women I've spoken to as well. And the more we move around the period and the more if we are active through it, I don't know how, but the pain, it's easier. It's somehow easier. The congestion is less. And I think it's just a cultural thing that you shouldn't move because it really is a great thing if you move. Because otherwise, what are you going to do? You're just going to lie in bed and it feels, we all know, if you just keep lying in bed, anything you have feels much worse because that's all your brain is focusing on. So yeah, I would say everyone should move. Take 1 day off if you need to. 2 days. I'm not saying that people don't have bad periods. I know people who have terrible pain and stuff. So I'm not talking to them, but the majority of us don't have such terrible pain or discomfort that we can't move.
It's a culture thing, right? I mean, how there's a taboo to girls being impure, temples are, you know, out of bounds for you. You're not allowed to be doing anything during that time. Isn't that such a big issue? How do we address that?
It's a very sad thing. And I think it's across communities.
It's across communities. Actually, it's across religions, which is very, it's very bizarre. And maybe it made some weird sense at one point in time that you thought that menstrual blood was dirty and thus couldn't enter a sacred place. But that doesn't make sense to me, but maybe it made sense to society at that point. But I don't see any logic in that now because I also think there's a lot of shame attached to menstrual blood, which I think people are now breaking. So I think maybe, and you know, the lady who ran the marathon, like she's bled through and she still continued to run and she finished. And I just saw that and it blew my mind. And I'm pretty progressive. I think I'm like, yeah, wow. Like, you know, most people would tell us to like, oh my God, you stained, run away, hydrate, whatever. But it's such a shame. Like it's just blood if you think about it. And I know I have much more of a comfortable relationship with blood because I'm a pathologist, but even then, like it's...
Thank you so much, Kamna. So both of you, how has your practice changed? How is it different from other people? Because you're one of those rare, one of those few active doctors. So how does that change your practice for both of you?
What I found actually was when I had stopped all these activities to some extent, for some reason I felt a lot more tired. And ophthalmology is a branch where you're pretty much sitting and operating continuously for about 5-6 hours. So I feel that it does help with your concentration to some extent. If you're doing something else, it does keep you more active in that sense. And your fitness level definitely helps you to get through a larger list of surgeries if you're looking at it purely from that point of view. Apart from that, for me at least, I find that the fact that I'm doing something else like golf, helped me to de-stress to a very large extent. And that's very important, because I got so fixated during post-graduation and fellowship that there was a complete tunnel vision, so to speak, of ophthalmology only, that I'd forgotten what kind of joy it gives me to do these kind of things, which challenge you. I mean, there's a separate level of satisfaction that you get once you either run a 5K or like we had done,
I think. But more like, it's just something distracting. It's just like, you know, it's also...
I think one of the fun things that we did together was I came to you when I had broken my leg after playing football match, and then we had a trip planned a few months after that to Italy, where we were going to climb up this active volcano in Sicily.
Yeah,
right?
In Sicily.
So initially I was like, I don't think I'm going to be allowed
to do
this. Roshan
was like, I can't do this. My ankle's broken. And so my family, right, we have this thing, because my parents are doctors too, like from the beginning we've been told, ki, you know, if one thing breaks or something happens, the world doesn't come stopping, crashing to a halt. You have to move forward. You have to look aage. Even if you're sick, you try to like, you know, move. Don't keep sitting, lying in bed. I've always been told, like, if you have fever, yes, rest. But don't keep lying in bed, because you'll feel much worse. So I tried to apply the same philosophy here. And I was met
with so much resistance. But actually, during that time, I did still go to the gym and train. And I was sitting down in a box and punching.
Yeah, so basically,
I
insisted that you have to go. And he thankfully listened. And so he was going, and he realized, I think it also helps you change barriers, like break those barriers in your brain where you decide ki ye nahi ho sakta, and then you do it, and then you realize acha ho sakta, and that you're actually doing pretty well. And then I think his ankle pretty much healed completely. I mean, he was coming to you guys, and then you told him, and I remember, because he came very proudly to me and he said, you know, by now I was told that my ankle is better and stronger than most people. So I'm like, great. Thank you.
And then the other ankle, which was not. That was good, and then we actually did climb up that.
Yeah, we did
volcano,
climb up that volcano.
So that was a good thing. So yeah. I think that's how basically it's helped, not only with practice but with generally experiences in life. I think that's been a great feature of fitness.
Yeah, it's a good relief. For me, it's like so pathology. You're sitting a lot, and you're sort of hunched over the microscope a lot. Because unfortunately, we do not have the money or the whatever resources for ergonomic microscopes. So we did Jugaad, as Indians are good at, and we would, you know, it's really problematic to stare at a microscope downward. So we would put like an incline under, like put stack three books and incline the microscope and work. But even then, it's really bad. Like the neck goes a lot of the time, the back goes. So I actually started my back pain. Went through the roof. I remember my final year postgraduate exams, and I was walking, and suddenly, you know, I used to go regularly for walks, because I'm addicted to walking or doing some physical activity. So I would go for these long walks, and my whole leg suddenly my left leg, I realized, would just entirely sleep off, like mid walk. And that's very, it's very freaking out, because it suddenly happens to you. So then I went and I showed, and at that point I was told, just take it easy, wear a belt, and they said, okay, try go for physiotherapy. But I had exams coming up. I had no time. Like, I mean, for people who don't know postgraduate, but I think people watching this would know postgraduate MD exams are, they're scary. So there's no time. So I did all that. I just ignored it. I did a heat pack, had lots of pre-GABA to get over with the pain, somehow finished those exams, got to Bangalore. And then I started a physiotherapy regime. But it was still better. But for me personally, what has happened over the years is, because then I came to Dr. Rajat in 2017, because I went to the gym, because I was like, I need to start going to the gym, because my back was doing fine for like 6 months. And then of course, I injured it again there, because of other people pushing me. But since then I've been training with you. But what I found is my back has never been stronger. Like, it's now I can do whatever and it doesn't go. Earlier, I would be really cautious about what I was doing, which action was I doing. And now I know, like, I know if I take care, nothing's going to happen. So I can, like, nowadays I am lifting, because we're in a lockdown, we're watering everything, we're doing all the work. So there's times that I'm lifting these huge buckets, because we have to go water the plants, and I'm fine. It's literally like a deadlift, but I know that my back is fine and it's going to be fine. So I think that's how it's changed me in my practice, because it really helps. I know some of my other colleagues as well who have neck pain and that, and then they've also started doing physiotherapy and they've started moving more. And it does really, really help with just, I mean, for us, it's sitting. So
and
it really
I think
helps
your point regarding colleagues, I mean, I know we all expect medical professionals to kind of be completely sedentary and sitting at home, but you kind of tend to get into either like a competition or kind of like inspire each other to do stuff. So I think a fair number of our friends are pretty much into some kind of activity and sport to a fairly great extent.
Some of them. Not all. Not it's all already sliding down, so we hope it doesn't.
Hopefully the lockdown is not affected that much. Yeah.
But some of our friends are really active. Like, they're even more active than we are, so it's great.
Thanks, guys. So tell me about this. While we're doing MBBS, and all three of us are agreeing, our course does not cater to movement, to exercise physiology, to fitness, to health. It's about illness, sickness. What do we do? Where do we change that? Where is the fault? How should we go about it that we are more aware rather than learning all this because, you know, we play football or we play golf? Shouldn't it be happening in a more structured fashion in a medical college, which is not happening at the moment?
Yeah, it's dead. I mean, you know, the first time I realized, so I'd always been like lower back pain. And I remember one of the first times I came to you, this is like after 8 years of medicine, right? So you think you know a lot. Or actually more than 8, right? And that's the first time when you told me that, you know, it's actually connected, because you took a detailed history and I told you about my knee, and my knee had been problematic in internship and no one had really paid attention to it. I said, okay, bhagna chhod do, running chhod do, dhyan karo, kuch nahi hoga, theek ho jayega. And I did give it up because, you know, it would swell up every time I did. And then I developed back problems 4 years later. And that's the first time when you said that, you know, the whole skeletal system is actually connected. So... You know, after 10 years or 8 years, it had never struck me that, you know, to extrapolate that part not working, okay.
But it is one body.
So I find that ridiculous, that I was a fairly, fairly interested student. So if it doesn't strike us, it's very bizarre. So it should be taught much better. I think we should be taught sports medicine, not as a part of maybe orthopedics. And not just teach us the pathology in orthopedics, but teach us about this part as well. Because in orthopedics, otherwise we're only doing... And orthopedics is taught in final year, and we're practically only doing exam cases most of the times.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, whereas like if you see medicine, we start from year to second year. We start from second year, literally. And so I think... I hope it's changing. I hear it's changing, some of the syllabus. So I hope it changes.
The second thing is, I don't know, whenever we used to play sports, even at a younger age, I don't think enough importance was given to warming up and cooling down.
Yeah,
I still think I am guilty of that. I have that tendency to think, theek hai, 5 minutes of warm up and I should be into it. And I don't think we stress that enough, even in our coaching systems or even in our PE periods in school.
Oh, never.
It's just like half an hour of unregulated running and playing football just on your own. It's like a free,
which is fine. You know, you need to let children have some unstructured time and be like jogi. But it could be, you could insist on certain things being done as a
habit. Importance of warming up and certain exercises before starting, I guess that,
or even cooling down, because most people, a lot of people just stop. And while it's fine if you feel your body can take it, but I mean, I find it easier to cool it off than just suddenly be like, go from a high intensity thing to just let's lie down on the floor now.
Totally. So how does that now change your practice, having had a fair share of your injuries, now being more aware of the whole body, the interconnected body that it is there? So how does it change your practice, whether it be for pathology, how you're telling your patients otherwise, or ophthalmology or general medicine practice? How are you looking at life and how are you telling patients differently now as compared to your colleagues, your friends who are not as active as you guys are?
So one thing is that they do take you a little more seriously if you tell them to exercise and you look like you do or you actually have. You're a little more convincing from that point of view. A second thing is there are certain myths around exercising which are associated with certain surgeries or procedure. Even in ophthalmology, if you have something like a LASIK surgery where we are correcting you for glasses, and a lot of people, most of my patients after that ask me, ki, should we just sit in a dark room for the next month? And I'm like, why? Why would you do that? Why would you just sit in a dark room? You have to be cognizant of the fact that you shouldn't get something going into your eye. That's a separate problem where you don't want particles going in your eye. But if you're going to a gym and running or jogging or even at home or anywhere, you're doing some kind of physical activity, it's not going to really affect the outcome of the surgery or put you at a higher risk for infection. It's a different question if you go and put something in your eye. That's a completely different thing. But so those kind of myths also, you can tend to bust those if you have that kind of background into what kind of activity.
How can you do it safely? Also, I'd say that a lot of people would say ki nahi time nahi milta ya fir hum gym nahi ja sakte. And that's an inadequate excuse because practically everything that you can do in a gym, I don't mean like some of those machines, but practically a lot of those things you can do home with a hook and a resistance band or even the TRX band. Like, you know, any of those things, you can do it at home. Like, and I mean, even not even that. Like, I used to be like, oh, I need some of that equipment. And now I realize I don't. I actually just need, even if I don't have, I can fill two bottles with water and use those if I need to. But it basically, I think it allows you to circumvent their excuse-making system and be like, nahi, par aap aise kar sakte ho. You know, so it's just, I think it's easier to preach when you actually follow it yourself.
Totally, totally. And the interesting thing about you guys is that you're just not, you know, the doctors and you're physically active. You actually have other hobbies. Please share with us other hobbies that you both love.
So, I do lots of things besides pathology, but that's one of my life's problems. I like too many things. So another thing that I am doing as well is pottery. And I think it's very important before I go into nutrition that I say that I think one of the things that you also taught me was that, you know, earlier if I had like a backache starting or something, I'd back off from things which I thought would put a strain on my back. But then you said, no, don't stop. If it's not impeding and like you gave me the go ahead, you would literally encourage me, ki karo. So I think that's very great because it sort of pushes you to, because having been through chronic pain, I know it becomes like this little vicious cycle where you try to, you know, safeguard and avoid things which will trigger it. But at the same time, you're letting go of things you actually enjoy, so which might actually calm you down and help you get better faster. So I think that's one thing. And so nutrition. Nutrition is something which, again, from very early on, I have had practical experience. And so basically my parents eat really well. They have always eaten like this. Like at home, we've always eaten, like, I won't say vegetarian or that, just well, like always encouraged to eat healthier things over unhealthy things. I mean, I have gone through my phase of Maggie also, like where we would eat Maggie every evening, but
especially in Manipal.
So when we met, Rushad, Rushad would be eating Maggie every day for breakfast, because, you know, before clinics, you'd eat and run. So that was one of the things I was like, ye nahi ho sakta. But, so anyway, so my parents always ate healthy. And somehow that's been imbibed in us. And Rushad finds this very bizarre, and most people find it very bizarre, but if I was ever offered a choice between a really nice salad and a bowl of, I don't know what, Maggie, I'd always choose salad. And to most people, this is very bizarre because most would just be like, are you mad? Which they also say I am. So nutrition's been a very bad journey. And, you know, as growing up, I was always thin and skinny and I would always hear this. And then, you know, you go through a phase in adolescence where, not proud of it, but I tried to starve myself. My parents tried not to let me do it. But, you know, when you're a stubborn kid and your parents are like, theek hai, experiment kar lo, and they're both doctors and they know that they're watching. They're not letting me eat so little that anything happens. But there was a phase where I was eating, I kid you not, half a chapati, maybe a 4 pieces of paneer, if that was a sabzi made, and a little bit curd. And that was my every meal. And I would watch everything that I ate. And sure enough, within 1 month, I fell ill. I fell ill another 2 times. And basically, I was ill for 3 times within 1 month. And that's when something went off in my brain. I think my mother told me, my father told me that, you know, this might have a relationship or a that with this, that you're eating so little that your body has nothing to fight with. You're already skinny enough to start with. So I have gone and starved myself. And then I've gone to the opposite extreme when I went to college. I decided to emotionally eat. I decided because I was so thin, I could afford to eat. So I would go and buy myself one. Barista used to do this brilliant biscotti kind of thing. I would go and eat one every day on top of all the ice creams. So I don't like sweets that much, but I adore ice creams. I can't live without them. So I would eat an ice cream every day on top of that also, almost every other meal. And we were eating out a lot. So when I came back, this is the real story. If my mom's not going to like it. But when I came back after 6 months of first year, my parents came to pick me up and my sister came as well. And I am walking towards them and I'm waving and my sister's waving back. And my poor mother is just like, but where is Kamna? I can't see Kamna because Kamna had put on so much weight that my mother did not recognize me. So yeah, so I'm both ways with nutrition, like dieting and this. And and then I decided to read a lot. Like once I came, once I had time actually, which was the last 2 years, 3 years, because you know, you give up in college, you eat whatever. When you're in post-graduation, you don't have time. So you do whatever. But the one thing I tried to always keep consistent was I always ate a lot of fruit. I liked eating fruit. I kept that up. I would always make sure that I was getting some kind of protein. So I would always eat eggs. And then I started reading a lot about that once I finished. And he's not very happy about it because he loves food and he loves all the crappy food. So yeah, so nutrition has been a journey. And I have come to a conclusion from a lot of experimentation with him and me. He's my guinea pig. Any diet which asks you to swing one way or the other in extremes too much is not a good diet. Like it's not anything which is not
sustainable.
I hate the word diet, and I'm sorry I'm using it, because it's just eating. Anything which asks you to eat too much of one thing and too little of the other, I'm sorry if that works for some people, but I really want to check how long it works for. And I actually sat and studied this, and most studies, even on keto diet, comparing it to other diets, at least when I read it a year back, was 2 years, and they don't really haven't followed it up what happens later. So and in that diet is, and in those studies, by the way, it was a meta-analysis, they came to the conclusion that actually in 2 years the amount of weight you would apparently lose with the keto versus a Mediterranean would almost always just come on, versus any other diet also would almost always come back to the same, would any, everyone would just come back to the same level. So, I mean, I don't say that Atkins is great either. Like, you know, there was a time when, so I don't advocate any diet. Like, and that's what I keep trying to tell him too, because there was this phase in, you tell him, there was his phase in, post-graduation?
Yeah, I decided to just stop eating. Almost like, crashed down to 1,000 calorie diet a day, and then I lost something like 15 kilos in 3 months.
And he was running, for like an hour every day or more. And when he came to Manipal that time to see me, I didn't recognize him. He literally looked a patient like a patient with tuberculosis. He was that starved. So yeah, he has these weird ideas about how he should be eating, which
have been all corrected now.
So yeah, no, but my point is you just have to eat all three things. You can't cut carb. Carb is important.
Yeah.
If you don't eat carb, so many things will not get absorbed in your body. So I'm not saying go eat sugar indiscriminately. That's the one thing I do say don't eat, like, you know, to anybody I care for. And most people will be able to say this. Most people I care for will have heard me lecturing them about
sugar.
So yeah.
It's unfortunate, no, though, how important nutrition is. And as doctors, we're not taught anything about it. About psychology, we don't know enough. what is happening or how should we be dealing with it? Diabetes not dealt with enough. What do you guys say?
Diabetes being such a big thing in India, I find it astounding that we. I'm wading into very controversial waters now if I say anything about most nutritionists around in our country. But you know, I wish there'd be. I really wanted a nutritionist at one point because I wanted to gain weight in a proper manner, and he needed to lose weight. So we were like, "Ek saath jayenge, bahut ka business milega doctor ko. Ek ko ek cheez denge, dusre ko dusri cheez denge." But we just couldn't find anyone, which is why I started reading so much about it and developed such an interest, because I don't know. I mean, there's some people I know who are supposed to be good, and but you know, to find someone who's actually done, like, let's say, exercise nutrition. I won't say sports nutrition, but that is.
You know, a lot of advice has been given. A lot of suggestions are being given by us without having experienced it ourselves, whether it be nutrition, whether it be physical activity, sports. And that is the sad part. And that changes when you're more aware, you start changing things and people trust you more.
So it's very bad because and we have so many diabetics. And the thing is, for diabetics, it should be integrated because they need to exercise. But when they exercise, their nutrition requirements will change. So, but you know, most diabetics would have been given a standard fixed thing that they have to stick along to. And that makes no sense. So,
I
don't know. I have a lot of very strong opinions about this. I don't think it's a good platform to discuss this.
It's been an absolute pleasure having you both on the podcast. So thank you guys for coming along. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, folks, who are watching this episode of Movement Medicine. Subscribe above or below, wherever it is, and watch for the new ones and like this channel to get more of such videos. So thank you so much, guys. Have fun.